God bless you. I pray that this message helps you. I'm telling you, I wanted to do this 3 weeks ago, but didn't get a chance to because so many other things were coming in my way. Now, this is going to be a part two because I need to set my clock here because I want to make sure, because like I said, you know, our listening span is so short. While we need to be hearing what the Spirit of the Lord is saying, many times we won't. We just won't. We won't stay tuned to what God is trying to say through different ones who God is saying something about a situation. So today I want to share with you, this is part one, we'll talk about discerning malign principalities. Now I'll break down what malign means in a few minutes, but I really want you to hear God concerning the message about principalities in just a few minutes. So, Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank that even now, Lord God, that you've just been so good. So anything that we've done, any gateways we've opened, God, to cause us to be in the position that we're in, Father, we pray that we can pull those down by the power of your blood, God. And we thank you that in Jesus' name, you said in your word, according to Matthew 5:44-5:45, Jesus, I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be sons of your Father in heaven. And we give you praise for what you're about to say through me today, Daddy. Be Lord on this call in Jesus' name. Now, I want to share with you what the Lord had visited with me about 3 weeks ago. And I know you may remember if you was on the call or saw the email about me talking to you about the spirit that's been released through the show Empire. Now, what has happened is that once someone is standing up against the gates of hell, much will come against that person. Well, I knew very right well that I was going to be fighting principalities, but not in the realm that I went through. I went through a lot of different realms of warfare, but I didn't think I was going to be hit like that, you know, because I'm constantly fasting and praying while I'm doing different shows. I'm fasting every day. I live a fasted life. But one thing, I know it might not show from all this chicken fat you may see, but I do fast. But one thing I want to share about this, discerning the malign principalities, is that this spirit that had attacked me is attacking me through the malign principality. And what happens to this spirit, and I want to define to you what malign is really quick. Maligning is when it comes from the Old English root meaning to attack. It means that we make evil and harmful and often untrue statements about people. And it means that our intention is strictly to wound and hurt the person by casting doubt on their character or their intentions. And a lot of times we find ourselves saying things very malignantly about people, and we don't even realize that that is a spirit. It is a principality that we have allowed, giving access, gateway, to cause a curse upon ourselves. The Bible tells us very clearly in Deuteronomy 27:24, I'm going to read the Amplified segment of it. It says, cursed is he who slays his neighbor secretly. And see, and what happens is coming through a gateway through a lot of methods that we use with our mouths, how we slay people by saying these things that are not true or trying to pull down their personality, that is character, by what you, out of your own mindset, believe or would like to hold on to your own thought. Now, does not make it righteous or right because of what I deem that we should or should not be doing, but it's just righteous based on scripture, you know, that we should not give our eye gate or our ear gate, you know, a time to even look upon or gaze upon this type of, activity on Empire. But long story short, before I get into this, we need to know that our words contain power, and we already know that according to Proverbs 18:21. But we also got to look at that power that we give our mouths comes from the abundance of our heart. And so we got to learn how to discern. And we can't discern how these principalities are gaining access or gateways to us because we're so full of ourselves that we begin to allow this curse to come upon us. Now, when I read to you a few moments ago, 27:24, But I want to read a little further. It says in 25, cursed be he that taketh reward to slay an innocent person. And all the people shall say amen. And then cursed be he, 26, that confirmeth not all the words of this law to do them. And so that means you don't accept it. You don't believe it's true. So that means you want to try to deal with the situation or deal with the way society thinks or get in, get in where you fit in to make it look like you're part of the clique or that you're not all so super spiritual. So you'll decide, I'm just going to watch it just to see what it's about. When actually you want to be in the clique with it. And this is why the gates are open toward that. And we can't discern things because we have opened gateways to principalities that have caused us to feel or think like it is okay. See, because these different types of principalities, they come in to enslave us. They come in to entice us. They come in to bring condemnation and to drive us to a place to seduce us, to want to be in that place. I'm going to try to slow it down. Thank you, Lord. And so let's look at Ephesians chapter 6. We all know that text, starting at verse 10, he says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to stand, there you go, be able to stand against the wiles of the devil, for we wrestle not against the flesh and blood, but against principalities. There it is. Against powers, against rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole, not part, armor of God, that you may be able to withstand the evil day, and having done all to stand, stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation, and the sword, there it is, that is Sunday, hey, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Not praying sometimes, but praying always, with all prayer and supplication, in the Spirit. And watching, key word, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. Lord, help us all today. And so that's why it's so easy that we can justify why we want to watch something or why it's important that we wind up putting, you know, this, our mouths on others. This malign principality, because it's a supernatural evil power that comes in the realm in these last days to get us to try to look at these carnal trends that we believe that it's not wicked, that it is just something to do, something to watch, you know, something to be a part of. But the church is the only body that is divinely empowered to stop the devil. And we have got to be able to pull down by the power of the blood and the cross of Calvary everything that is not looking like, sounding like God. You hear me? That means it's not lined up with the word of God. And so before I go any further, I want to talk a little bit about the gates. Because this malign spirit, what it has done is caused people to have their mouths on you in one fashion and a smile on your face, on their face in another fashion, because they're undercover. And the reason why they're undercover right in your face is because you can't discern the devil when you see it. Thank God that he gave us an example with Judas. Right in God's, right in Jesus' face, he said, do what you're going to do, but you need to do it quickly. See, the gatekeeper is important for you and for your family and for your ministry. Because what the gatekeeper does, it clicks the sounds the alarm in the spirit realm for your eyes to see in the spirit and discern what you have standing before you, what you have talking in your soulish realm for what you like and what you want. God help us all today. And so, so goeth the head, so goeth the body. And whoever controls the gate, they rule the city. It's very important that we know and we look at how these gates of hell, all of these gates of hell, Jesus has told us over and over again that the gates of hell should not prevail. But we open up these gateways where the enemy can come in very suddenly and allow our eye gate to get involved with situations. See, these gatekeepers have names. And many of these that are in us are still active because we have never been delivered from anything. We just took the right hand of fellowship, and there we go. Kept on memorizing scripture and understanding things about the word, but yet we never demonstrated in true real life. We only had the intellect and no power. And so the gatekeeper of our soulish realm, many of them are sexual lust, many of them are adultery, fornication, perversion, lesbianism, homosexuality. And we don't want to leave out just simply uncleanness, masturbation and so on. But these are related to the gatekeeper. Well, why? The gatekeeper of your own soul. Each of us have these gatekeepers. And what happens is that when you close your opportunity to have God speak to your heart about what is going on, then you don't have any defense, because now every attack from these gatekeepers that we are hiding, at least we think we hide behind, are going to manifest at some point. And so let me tell you what happened one day before I launched my show about Empire. I was driving down the street, and I had an appointment that was supposed to come to see me that evening for a consultation about something. And that was a Sunday evening. And so I made the trip, and as soon as I got at a certain location on this road, the Holy Spirit said for me to immediately start to pray in my prayer language. And so I began to pray in my prayer language, and I was just steady in the Spirit going, "Why, Daddy, what's going on? Why? And he immediately let me remind me about the show. I went, "Oh, yeah. Yeah, so I'm in that kind of war. I feel that war zone." So I don't know about you, but when you start to cross in different regions or go in different areas of the city, even in the grocery stores in your neighborhood, sometimes the atmosphere will shift. And you'll begin to feel heaviness on your neck or your back start hurting, or you get a quick headache. But what happened for me, this malign principality, what it did, it came in to attack my mind. I don't want to get ahead of God, so I'm praying I get part of this in before the veil rang so I can go to part two, because half of you probably go, "Oh, part two, I want to see it. I want to hear it." But we got to know that these spirits, these malign principalities, they have come so they can harass us, torment us, and most importantly, what they want to do is enslave you so that you can't think. The devil is a lie. I thank God for living a fasted life, because at that particular time, I was fasting. And what happens as I begin to cross in that region, he told me to pass in my, to go into my tongues. He said, "Then now I need you to discern what is happening here." When I crossed over from where I was, where I'm taking authority in the region where I'm at, I left the region and crossed over to another region that was highly infected with gang and perversion and everything you could think of, in that region. When I got over there in that region, immediately that a malign spirit, because I had to pray about to understand what it was, the malign principality is what I want to call it, because, this is one that sits in the high place. These are people that are of authority. These are people that are chanting and doing witchcraft, These are the people. Now, I'd already felt that malign spirit coming, but I could not ID it until after I got the attack upon it. And as I began to pray in my language, all of a sudden, I felt this pressure to come on my head where it felt like a band. And immediately the Lord said, "It's a band of wickedness." I mean, the bond of wickedness. The enemy is trying to put you in this bondage of wickedness over your mind. Ah, Sunday, I know I'm talking to somebody. And immediately I had already oiled myself up before I left, but I wanted some oil in my hand. And the Lord said, "Put your hand on your head right now." Immediately while I was driving, I put one hand on my head, and I began to just to prophesy and pull down and bind and loose and pray my mind to be sound, and everything that tried to come against me, every principality, any gateways I opened, I pulled it down and renounced it and the whole nine. But during that time when I was praying, my phone rang. My God, I'm about to get up out of this chair every time I think about it. My phone rang, and my phone rang. It was my appointment. They didn't have the address, my address, to get to me. And she said, "What is your address? I want to put it into my, the map thing." And I went to go to talk. And when I went to go to talk, I was confounded. I couldn't think. I didn't know my address. I didn't even know where I was. Lord, help us all today. I had to think, where am I going? What? She said, your address. I said, oh, my address. My address? I don't know. Let me think. Then I rattled off a number. It wasn't my address. It was my office address. And I'm like, oh, no. That's my office. That's wrong. And I know she probably was like, what's wrong with Dr. Murphy? And I went, oh, girl, wait, I'm going through something right now. I said, please, just give me a minute. Give me a minute. And then, and I was just sitting within going, Jesus, help me. Jesus, help me. And I was confounded that malign spirit was constantly charging me with witches, mad, and leadership who was of authority talking against me because I wanted to do this show. The Lord made it very clear to me, but it took a couple of days. That's why I believe he didn't allow this until now. You know, for me to really understand what was it called, what was its name. It was a malign spirit. So what that spirit does is they're to slay me through their lips. You know, they want to slay me secretly, or they want to slay me openly. And really what they're doing, they're living a curse. Because everything that they spoke, they ate the fruit of it themselves. But we got to understand that thing had me so confounded, and I could not remember my address to the point that, you know, I didn't know what to think. I didn't know what to do. Then finally, she gave me a couple minutes, and I went, okay. I had to slowly think, what is my home address? Gave her my address, and then I said, I got to go. I got to hang up. I said, because I'm trying to pray this off of me, whatever this is, because I still hadn't had the name of it yet. Okay, there's a phone. I want you to think on these seven principalities that the enemy tries to do against us in the heavenlies, because we're talking about the principalities, okay? And so we want to look at deception. We want to look at the lust of the flesh. We want to look at the lust of the eyes. We're going to look at the lust of power, and we know empire fits all these principalities. Harlotry, the fear, the simple fear, and death. All of this is all dumped into this particular show, and also are engulfed in the malign as it relates to relationship, as it relates to people trying to defame your character or pull you down so that people won't hear you, or that is, hear the voice of God through you. And we got to bind and loose in a very strategic way to pull down the battle in the heavens. I'm going to part two. Hope you get a chance to listen.